Please turn there in your Bibles. I'm going to read a couple of verses from Matthew and then pray. These verses in Matthew are actually taken from the parallel account of the parable of the sower. So listen to what Jesus tells his disciples there. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. So pray with me. Father, we want to see what these prophets and righteous men longed to see. We want to hear today what they long to hear, and we need your help to do that. We need you to give us clarity and give us understanding. And we need you to help us to grasp not just what the scriptures say, but what they mean. So through your incarnate word, through your indwelling spirit, give us what we ask, Lord, as your dearly loved children. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So by reading that verse, really, we see that this is extremely important. If Jesus is saying that all the prophets and all the righteous men up until that point in his life had longed to see this and to hear this, then I don't think of anything that could be more important than that. This is what they all were looking forward to. This is what they longed to hear, longed to see. So in dividing up the book of Mark, you know, as Josh and Mark and I have had to do that, we're actually, you know, I was kind of grateful. I get the parable of the sower. It's really straightforward. It's easy to understand. And I kind of regret that now, even though it's been it's been a difficult study, but it's been a rich study. It's challenging. At surface level, yeah, it's simple. There's a simple explanation for what the parable of the sower means. But there is so much more here. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to look at this parable. We're going to look at Jesus' explanation of it. And then we're going to come back and we're going to dwell on, we're going to just camp on the middle part of this passage. Okay? Because that's where the meat is. That's where the meaning is. Why have there been so many different responses to Jesus? We've seen throughout the first three chapters that there's different groups of people. There's the crowds who flock to Jesus. There's the Pharisees who kind of oppose him and accuse him of things. There's the demons who cry out, who profess that they know who he is, and they fall before him. There's the disciples who follow him but really don't understand who he is. Why? We've looked at a few things. There's been an expectation that hasn't quite been met. So the Jewish people expecting a kingdom coming that doesn't really fit into what Jesus is doing. That's part of it. Jesus kind of upsets their traditions, you know. His disciples don't have to wash their hands before they eat. We see that in Mark chapter 7. Jesus parties with the wrong people. He eats with tax collectors and sinners. Teachers, rabbis aren't supposed to do that. What else? His family, Jesus' own family, flesh and blood, think that he's crazy. He's lost his mind. The Pharisees have accused him of breaking the Sabbath, of doing things that only God can do, forgiving sins, and of being possessed by the prince of demons. So there's quite a few different responses to Jesus. Why is that the case? Well, the parable of the sower explains to us why that is the case. The seed gets planted, but it gets planted on a variety of different types of soil. And it doesn't always take root and germinate and bring forth a harvest. Jesus says that this is the way it works with planting seed. The Pharisees oppose him and accuse him. The crowds want to use him for their own purposes. The disciples follow him but are confused by him. The demons fall before him, professing him to be the Holy One of God. So let's get into this a little bit. Mark chapter 4. Here we have the setting. Again, he began to teach beside the sea, and a very large crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea. And the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. And he was teaching them many things in parables. So this is the setting. Jesus is out by the sea. This is the Sea of Galilee up north. And apparently, you know, people do lots of research on this stuff. Apparently, there's a natural amphitheater along the sea at the shore of Galilee. So maybe this was the place. Who knows? But you can imagine it. You can picture it. There's this natural bowl carved into the rock along the sea. Jesus is on the boat in the middle of a bay. And this place is actually called the Bay of Parables. And he's speaking to the crowd. And it's a whole big, large crowd. How many people, we don't know. Several thousand, possibly. A large crowd. He's in the boat. He's teaching them. He's teaching them in parables. And in his teaching, he said to them, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seed fell on rocky ground, where it did not have much soil, and immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seeds fell into good soil and produced grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And he said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." That is going to kind of be the refrain throughout this whole passage of Scripture. If you flip over in your Bible or look at the end of the chapter, verse 33, he says, "With many such parables, he spoke the word to them as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his own disciples, he explained everything." The focus here, obviously, is to pay attention, to listen. Here's the picture. A guy goes out to sow seed, and he sows seed basically everywhere. He sows seed on a hard path. He sows seed in rocky soil. He sows seed among other weeds, and he happens to just sow seed in good soil that produces a natural fruit. That's the parable. Now imagine, you know, being there and hearing those words and then trying to figure out what exactly is he talking about. Here is the teacher of Israel, the one who teaches with authority, the one who has a new teaching that can't fit into the old wineskins, and that's all you have. I don't know if you like riddles. Some of you may like riddles or mysteries. They're kind of designed to get you to pay attention, to dig in. You know, most of the time, if I'm faced with something that's challenging, I just kind of want to give up. I don't want to waste my energy and time thinking about a riddle for hours and hours and hours. But maybe you like them. I can't imagine that the people did, because it's pretty vague. What is he talking about? Why is he talking about a farmer sowing seed? Why is he talking about what the seed can do in different types of soils? But thankfully, he doesn't leave us without an explanation. He tells us exactly what it's about. And that's where we get to in verse 14 is where we'll start looking at the explanation of the parable. But first, the focus is on hearing. So this is what's going to come out in the explanation. He begins the parable with the command to listen. He concludes the parable with the enigmatic phrase, "He who has ears, let him hear." Basically, if you have ears, then use them. Put them to use in understanding what I'm saying. But listen to the explanation. So, verse 14. The sower sows the word. These are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy, and they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then, when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. Others are the ones sown among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. So the sower is a picture of, we could say, Jesus himself, sowing the word. What is going forth? What is the seed that's going out to the soil? It is the word, the gospel of the gospel that Jesus is proclaiming, the good news of the kingdom of God, the good news of God himself and what God is going to do to come and rescue his people. That's the word that's being planted, and it's planted in different types of soils. It's actually doesn't get planted on the path. The path is too compact where the word can't penetrate into the soil, so it just sits there. Birds come and snatch it away. That's the evil one. He comes and plucks the seed out, takes it away from the people so that it doesn't take root in their hearts. There's another type of soil that is actually shallow soil, and underneath the soil is rocks. Now, the seed can be planted in the soil and it can sprout, but when the sun comes out, when there's pressures of life, he calls them here persecutions, tribulations that arise on account of the word, that's going to kill the plant. The plant is scorched. They fall away, he says. And then there's the seed that's planted in the soil along with the weeds, the thorns, in verse 18. They hear the word, but the cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. So a life that is complicated, it's not focused solely on the word, there's a response, the plant grows, but then it becomes preoccupied with other things. Deceitfulness of riches, the worries of the world, and it chokes it out so that it cannot bear fruit. But then there is the seed that's sown on good soil, and it produces a bumper crop, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold, which is quite extraordinary. That soil receives it, accepts it for what it is, and produces fruit. So why have there been so many different responses to Jesus? It's because the seed, the word, has landed on lots of different types of soil. Not everyone accepts the word that he proclaims. Some accept it with joy, but it lasts for only a little while. Some accept it, but then they become preoccupied with other things, and it chokes that word out. But there are some, 25%, if you're going statistically, that receive it, accept it, and bear fruit. Okay, so we're all there. That's the explanation of the parable. That's in a sense, that's what Jesus is saying. What does it mean? For that, we have to go back to, well, first of all, notice that everybody hears the word. All the soils hear the word. Some don't even get a chance to respond to it. Some respond to it with joy, but just for a little while. Some to respond to it and grow for a little while until it's choked out. And others respond to it and have an abundant harvest. Everybody hears the word, but the response does not always produce fruit. So we know that hearing is key, but the type of hearing that Jesus is aiming at is what is important. What type of hearing is he actually talking about here? So for example, Let's say you're out walking in the woods and you hear a voice. So somebody cries out, "Help me, help me." And however sound travels in waves, it comes across the terrain and it enters into your ear, and your ear does some magic and your brain says, "That's a voice. I hear somebody crying. Help me, help me." I don't know exactly how all that works, but I just assume that it does. That's hearing, right? Noise comes into your ear, you hear something, a noise. Now, there's a different level of hearing, which would be a level of understanding. You know what the person is actually saying. Help me is a cry, a plea for someone to come and rescue them. Somebody's in trouble. Now, do you have to respond to that call? Do you have to respond to the call for help? No. So that's hearing in a different sense. But the response that everybody should have is, okay, I need to do something now. Not only has the noise gone into my ear and my brain did some magic so I could process what was going on, but I understood what they were saying. It was a cry for help. But it calls me to respond to it. I need to call 911, or I need to run to where that voice is coming from to help this person. That's the type of response that Jesus wants with the imperative to listen, to call, to hear. If you have ears to hear, he doesn't just want people to pay attention to him. He wants people to respond. If you have ears to hear, then do what I say. Respond to this word that I'm preaching to you. It's kind of reminiscent of the Shema in Deuteronomy chapter 6. This is how this central prayer of the Jews begins, with the call to hear. And actually, if you look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, you don't have to go there. It says, "Hear, O Israel, listen, pay attention, respond. The Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might." So not only recognizing this and saying this as a prayer that they prayed morning and night, which is what they did, but responding to this. What does it mean that God is one? You should love him, be devoted to him, not to any idols. He is your God. A similar word is used in Exodus 19. Actually, it's the same word, but Bibles translate it differently because they understand that it's more than hearing or listening. Let's see if I can find it. Okay, this is Exodus 19, verse 5. "Now therefore," talking to the people that he's just rescued and brought to the mountain, "now therefore, if you will indeed," my translation says, "obey my voice," the word is the same, "if you hear my voice, now indeed, if you hear my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So obviously God implies in this command to hear, to listen, he commands a response. Not just to pay attention audibly to what is being said, but to respond to him, to keep his covenant, so that they would be his people. That's what Jesus is getting at here. Listen, pay attention, respond to what I am saying. What does it mean, though? There's a secret. Jesus tells secrets. So I don't know if you're comfortable with that, but he does. He tells secrets, and he tells the secret about this parable to his disciples. So if you're familiar with insider-outsider terminology, you know what it's like to be in a clique or to be on the outside of a clique, to be in a group of people, to be included or not to be included. That's what's going on here. So look at Look at the explanation of why Jesus is teaching in parables. This is the part that we skipped. It's verses 10 through 13. And when he was alone, back in Mark, and when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parables. And he said to them, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven." And he said to them, "Do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables?" So Jesus says this knowledge, this secret, or perhaps your Bible uses the word mystery, this mystery of the kingdom is given to you. So the 12 disciples and those who were with them, this is given to you. This is a gift. God is giving this to you. You didn't achieve it. You didn't attain it. I have a secret, and I'm giving it to you. That's what he's saying. But for everyone else, for those on the outside, those on the outside of the group, everything is in parables. So all they're going to get is Mark 3 through 9. That's it. They're left on the outside trying to figure out on their own. And there's a purpose for that, which we'll get to. But what does it mean that this secret has been given to them? Because they don't seem to understand what Jesus is saying, even when he explains it to them. So implied in this, I think, is the idea that they will come to know and understand what Jesus is saying. I think that's probably why Mark writes about it in his gospel. But the disciples, at least as Mark portrays them, they are just as confused as everybody else. The only difference is that they've responded to his call, to follow him. That's the only difference. At the end of this chapter, they ask the question, Jesus asked them the question, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And then they got afraid, and then they said, "Who is this? Who is this that the winds and the waves obey him?" Chapter 6, Jesus is going to say that they have hard hearts. That doesn't sound like people who are on the inside who understand the mysterious parables about the kingdom. They will, though, and that's the point. The seed is planted, and in God's purposes, they have good soil, and they will bear forth good fruit, a harvest, 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. But what is the secret of the kingdom of God, the mystery of the kingdom of God? So the only place where these two, at least in Jesus' Bible, the only place where these two ideas show up is in Daniel chapter 2. So we're going to go back to Daniel chapter 2 and spend some time here. The mystery of the kingdom of God. So we know that Jesus gets on the scene and he announces the nearness of the kingdom. The kingdom of God is at hand. And we've talked a little bit about what that is. And we talked a lot about what that's not. But we understand that when he says that, the people have something in mind, right? They have an idea of what this kingdom is going to be like. Part of their ideas where this, what this kingdom is going to be like, come from Daniel chapter 2. So in case you're not familiar with the story, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, has a dream. He has a dream that really confuses him. He has no idea what it's about. So he gets together all of his people. He brings all of the magicians and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans. He brings them to them. He threatens them that if nobody can tell me what my dream means, then I'm going to tear your arms off. So, of course, everybody's scared. Daniel is there with his companions. And one of the captain of the king's guards goes to Daniel. And Daniel says, "Hey, give us some time. I'll make an appointment with the king and we'll see what we can do." So the captain of the guard does that. He has an appointment with King Nebuchadnezzar, and Daniel prays. So this is Daniel, we'll start, I guess, in verse 17. Daniel went to his house. He made the matter known to his buddies, told them to seek mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery. so that Daniel and his companions might not be destroyed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision of the night. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belong wisdom and might. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and hidden things. Who knows what is in the dark? He knows what is in the darkness, and the light dwells with him. To you, O God of my fathers, I give thanks and praise, for you have given me wisdom and might, and have made known to me what we asked of you, for you have made known to us the king's matter." So this mystery, what the meaning of the dream is revealed to Daniel. Did Daniel kind of figure it out on his own? Did he put two and two together and, okay, I know what this vision of the statue is, this dream of the statue? No, he doesn't do that on his own. God is the one who reveals it. So with that in mind, thinking about the disciples and those who were with him, what is Jesus saying? To you has been given the mystery of the kingdom. The same thing that happened with Daniel. It's been revealed to Daniel, and now it's being revealed to you. Okay, so what is the mystery? Now we could probably, this is a kind of a long chapter. I don't want to spend too much time on it. So he goes in, he sees Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel tells the king, no wise men, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show to the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. This is what your vision is. It's been revealed to me, verse 30, not because of any wisdom that I have, more than all the living, but in order that the interpretation may be made known to the king, and that you may know the thoughts of your mind. This is the vision. There's a statue. It has a gold head. It has a silver chest and arms. It has a bronze belly and thighs, I think. And then it has an iron legs. And then its feet are made out of iron and clay. And then there's a rock. There's a rock that comes out that's not cut by human hands. And the rock smashes the feet of the statue. And the statue is destroyed. And then that rock grows into a mountain. What is the interpretation of that? God reveals it to Daniel. This is what Daniel says. There's going to be some kingdoms. Let's see, where do I pick this up? Okay, so you are, O king, King Nebuchadnezzar, the King of Kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power and the might and the glory, and into whose hand he has given wherever they dwell, the children of man, the beasts of the field, and the birds of the heavens, making you rule over them all. You are the head of gold. That's verse 38. 39, another kingdom inferior to you shall rise after you, and yet a third kingdom of bronze, and which shall rule over all the earth. Medes and the Persians. There shall be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, because iron breaks to pieces and shatters all things, and like iron that crushes, it shall break and crush all these. I think that's the Greeks. And you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron. It shall be a divided kingdom, but some of the firmness of iron shall be in it, just as you saw iron mixed with the soft clay. The toes of the feet were partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. As you saw the iron mixed with soft clay, so they will mix with one another in marriage, but they will not hold together, just as iron does not mix with clay. That's the Romans. Verse 44, and in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. That's the rock. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever. Just as you saw that a stone was cut from a mountain by no human hand, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold. A great God has made known to the king what shall be after this. the dream is certain and its interpretation is true. So Nebuchadnezzar has a dream of the statues. The statues represent different successive kingdoms, his own and then the ones that were following him after his. And in the days of the last kingdom, the kingdom of Rome, there is going to be a rock that's cut out that destroys those kingdoms, that's going to be established forever, that's going to grow and become a mountain. Now, the thing about mountains is they can't really be destroyed. You can destroy a statue, you can cut down a tree, but you can't destroy a mountain. That is the dream. So those two ideas, that God is the revealer of mysteries, and that as the revealer of mysteries, this kingdom is going to come in the days of Rome. Jesus says, the secret of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you. Okay, how do they fit together? What's the relationship here? It's easy to see Daniel's vision and say, the kingdom was what the Jews expected it to be. Okay, if that's the image that they have, that's the base that they're working from, then it's obvious. This kingdom is going to be a mighty conquering kingdom that's going to destroy, obliterate all the other kingdoms of the world. So their expectations were pretty consistent with what Daniel's saying. So why does Jesus still refer to it as a mystery? Because the way that the kingdom came and the type of kingdom that it was not that expectation. Yes, it was powerful. Yes, it would destroy kingdoms, but not in the way that the people expected it to be. That's the secret. The secret is understanding that the nature of this kingdom is not coming in the way that you would expect it to come, but it's coming through a message. It's coming through a savior. It's coming compare a farmer to a mighty warrior. Jesus is saying the kingdom is coming like a farmer who plants seed, not like a mighty warrior who wields a sword. Surprise. Everybody would have been shocked by this. And it's no wonder that they didn't get it. Okay, so back to Mark. So Mark 4:10, and when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parable. So this is another hint at why these people were different. You know, they didn't just sit confused wondering what Jesus was saying or assume that they knew what he was saying. They went to him. Hey, what was that about? He said to them, to you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside, everything is in parables. Why? So that they may indeed see but not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven. This is probably some of the most difficult words that Jesus spoke in his entire ministry. He's giving the secret of the kingdom, how the kingdom is going to come, not like a mighty warrior, but through a message of the kingdom, like seeds being planted by a farmer. For everyone else, it's in parables. It's going to remain this riddle. It's going to remain this mystery that they are to respond to, but the purpose that they're in parables is so that they may not understand it. Now, normally we think of parables, I think the popular phrase is that they are an earthly illustration of a heavenly truth or something along those lines. Maybe you've heard those things. The parables, you know, are like sermon illustrations. They're designed to make something clearer. I want to help people understand what I'm saying, so I'm going to give you an illustration that you can relate to, that you can understand, and then you can understand what I'm saying. But that's the opposite of what Jesus says here. This is challenging. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven. Now we could soften this and we could say that that wasn't the purpose of the parables, that was simply the result. So Jesus spoke in parables to give people understanding, but it just didn't happen that way. I don't think you can do that linguistically. The purpose is communicated by the so that in verse 12. For those outside, everything is in parables. For the purpose that they may indeed see and not perceive, hear and not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven. What do we do with that? How do we understand that? Because that seems to be not consistent with who we understand Jesus to be. I think a hint is that we see God's divine purposes here. We see that there are those who respond to Jesus already in his ministry, that they oppose him, that they have not received his word with gladness, that they accuse him of being under the power of the devil and his demons. They've already rejected him, so the parables then confirm their rejection. It keeps them blind, basically, is what Jesus is saying. It keeps them, their hearts hard because they've already rejected him. Why would God want to do that? Why would God want these people to be hard? This is where we have to bow our heads and cover our mouths, because we cannot respond to God in this way and say, God, it's not fair. God's purpose is that the kingdom would be hidden. In Jesus' ministry, that it would be veiled to those people. Yes, some by grace, some would receive the understanding of the kingdom. Other people will not. Why? Because it's designed to be hidden for a time. And we're going to sneak ahead and look at the next section. Listen to what he says, verse 21. He said to them, is a lamp brought in to be put under a basket or under a bed and not on a stand? For nothing is hidden except to be made manifest, nor is anything secret except to come to light. If anyone has ears to hear, let him hear. The purpose for hiding the kingdom in parables about farmers and sowing seeds and messages about the power of God's word is so that at a point in the future, it would be revealed. It would be made manifest. There is intentionality here. This is God's plan. He's hiding the identity of his Savior, the conquering King Messiah, in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. He's hiding him in that person who says the wrong things, who visits the wrong people, who is opposed by the religious leaders, so that at a future point in time, he could be made manifest. Where does that come together? Where do those two conflicting ideas, paradoxical ideas, come together? It comes together at the cross. Why do their hearts have to be hard? Because Jesus has to be crucified. Because the king has to be defeated. That's why. This is the mystery of God's plan. It's a mystery that remains hidden throughout the Gospels, but is revealed at the crucifixion and resurrection. We can't object to it. We can't raise our fists in God's face and say, how could you do something like that? No, we submit, humble submission, to the God who does stuff like this. To the God who has a plan that subverts human wisdom, human knowledge, human striving. And it has a plan of a crucified king. A man who would become king through crucifixion and resurrection. That's how Jesus becomes king. He dies. No one saw that coming. Some would see it as foolishness. Some would see it as a stumbling block. But for those who are called, we see our Savior, our Messiah. We see the power and wisdom of God. So a couple of illustrations. The great classic children's game, hide and seek. We've all played it. Now, how long would you play the game if you never got found? You're going to hide, but what's the purpose of the hiding? Purpose of the hiding is ultimately that somebody would find you. Because no one's going to keep playing the game if you can't find anybody. That's not a fun game. You go and you hide so people can find you. Another example, why do we wrap presents? We wrap presents so we can hide them. Why do we wrap them, though? Is so that they can be unwrapped, so they can be revealed, so people can be in a surprise and see what actually is happening. Oh, you got me this great gift. That would be really lame Christmas morning if you put all the presents underneath the tree and none of them are wrapped. Maybe you do that when you get older and you don't have kids anymore. I don't know. But the purpose of the wrapping is so that it would be revealed. The secret of the kingdom is that it would be hidden for a time. It's going to be revealed to those who, by God's grace, understand it and approach Jesus for it. Give us understanding. Help us to grasp these things. To those who hear the word, not just audibly, but pay attention to it. That hear the riddles and are drawn to them to seek understanding. The passage is filled with that. Hear the word, listen. But only one soil bears fruit. Only one soil produces a harvest. So we know that in one sense, asking the question, what type of soil are you, is not really what Jesus is aiming at. He's describing the soils in his own ministry. Isaiah's, the quote, we didn't even look at it. Isaiah's quote, you know, this is the quote that seeing they may they may indeed see but not perceive and may indeed hear but not understand lest they should turn and be forgiven. That was Isaiah's ministry. The great passage where he sees Jesus in all of his glory. He cries out that he is a man of unclean lips. He dwells among a people of unclean lips. And then an angel comes and atones for his sin, burns his lips, purifies them. And he responds, you know, God says, who am I going to send? You know, and Isaiah says, you can send me now. Okay. If you stop there, you never see the whole picture. What messages does he have? What message is he sent out with? He's sent with a message like this. They may indeed see but not perceive. They may indeed hear but not understand. What kind of message is that? It's a message of judgment. It's a message of hardening. And it's the picture that for all of Israel's life, they have been hardened against God. When did they ever receive the seed of the word? The seed was sown among them for years, for generations. When did they ever respond to that? Was it in the wilderness? No. Was it in the promised land? No. Was it when they left the promised land? No. Was it when they returned from the promised land or returned from exile? No. But in Jesus' ministry, the fields are ripe for harvest. They're ready. That's what he's doing. He's sowing the seed. So for years, generations, Israel has heard the word and responded to it negatively. Stephen says, you always, in Acts 7, you always resist the Holy Spirit as our fathers did. The seed was sown on bad soil. What Jesus is saying is that there is going to be a time of abundant harvest. And that is a mystery that will be revealed. So we stand as a part of that harvest. We stand as those who he calls blessed to see what the prophets long to see. That is our inheritance. But you need to respond to what Jesus is saying, though. We can't just take his word in without responding to it. So, in a way, we can secondarily apply this. How is it that you respond to him? How is it that you respond to his word? How is it that you respond to the crucified king? Do you bow the knee? Do you reject his word? Do you make fun of it? You know, this is ridiculous. Who could believe this? Is this just a fairy tale? You know, people were not scientific back in the first century Palestine, so this is just made up stuff. Or maybe you receive it with a little bit of joy, like, yeah, Jesus is going to allow me to have my best life right now. Maybe that's your response. And then life gets hard and you're like, oh, I don't really want anything to do with that Jesus guy. This is not what I signed up for. Do you want to get rich? You want the new car or the vacation home or the latest gadget? You know, that becomes more of your passion, your drive in life than actually honoring your Savior. You can't serve two masters, Jesus says. You'll hate the one and love the other, or devoted to the one and despise the other. So yeah, in a way, we can apply it this way, knowing that it's not ultimately the point, but we have to respond to Jesus. Do we continue speaking in parables? Wouldn't that be fun? I wonder how big the church would be if we did. Or maybe people would leave because they understand the parable. It wasn't a really good one. But listen to Paul. The mystery's been revealed. This is what he says. We are not like so many peddlers of God's word, but as men of sincerity, as commissioned by God. In the sight of God, we speak in Christ. We have renounced disgraceful, underhanded ways. We refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word, but by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. That's not speaking in parables. Open declaration of the truth. That is the day that we live in. We're not keeping anything hidden anymore.